Welcome, welcome everyone to our second portfolio review here in the Twitch channel, which will of course be in YouTube later on. And today we're going to be starting strong, very strong, with Raisen Topobroto from Jakarta, Indonesia. For those of you that are new to this series, remember that every single month you can submit your portfolios to our Discord channel, and you guys are going to be able to be featured here in our live stream so that we review, and I'm going to give you my opinion on what things you could do to make your portfolio better and get you more chances to land at your dream job. So let's go. We got several people here in the chat. We got Backboy, Kokoeli, Sarn. We got the Hidden was here a little while ago. Daniel, so welcome everyone, and let's get started. So Rasan didn't leave any Phantom. There you go. Rasen didn't leave any message on the Discord. You guys are welcome to leave me a little message. Tell me a little bit about yourselves. What are you looking for when you're applying for your portfolio review? And that gives me a little bit more information on how to help you get to that point. So let's see. Rasen has here as 7 pieces. And the first thing I see about the 7 pieces is that he has 2, I would say maybe 3 really strong ones, and then exercises. We've talked about this before. Rasan, if you're listening, one of the things that I mentioned about exercises or assignments like this one right here, they're good. Like, actually, your animation here is really, really good, really fluid. That's very nice. However, if you just want to be modeling or doing characters, which from your other submissions, I think that's your main goal, then this one might not be the best option to have on your portfolio. Another advice I would give you is to try to clean some stuff here. Like, I understand that this was an animation assignment, not a modeling one, but if you can present this animation in a better light, better texture on the background, better like textures here on the, like blank canvas or something, that will make this piece a lot stronger. And you can keep it here because it's a really good animation, to be honest, without having to remove it. But for instance, this one right here, at least the thumbnail looked a little bit weird. It's very grainy, very like old quality. I understand what you were going for, which was this sort of found footage sort of stuff. But as an assignment, it's really not ideal. And this thing right here, I'm not a nuke artist, so I'm not sure I understand what is going on here, but it does look very messy. So I know there are ways to link and clean your graph a little bit better. Remember, guys, presentation is super important. So even this sort of stuff tells me that, and I don't want to be mean by saying this, but it tells me that it's very, yeah, Sarn is right, it's very chaotic, right? So if this is the way you organize like your files and your workspaces and things like that, when you go into a pipeline that's very like organized, you might have some issues. So you always want to try to clean things up, because imagine that I am a nuke artist and you hand me this scene and you give me this, I'm gonna be like, damn, what's this? I'm gonna have to like spend more time than I should trying to understand what you were doing before I can start doing my part of the job. So that's why when you're working on, again, on a production pipeline or in a team, you need to try to keep things as organized as possible, because there will be more people involved and you don't want to make it difficult for them. Okay, so that's that would be this 3 first pieces. Again, it's not bad. Your walk cycle, the run cycle right there, it looks cool, it's fine. I can see that you were copying this clouds, that's great. But it's the kind of stuff that I would probably not have on my portfolio. This is the kind of exercises, and I mentioned this frequently, we're probably gonna see this a little bit more in some of the other portfolios. There's a difference between a portfolio work and an exercise. Some exercises can be portfolio worthy because you can get a really nice result and they're like good to showcase. But most of the exercises, assignments, homeworks, and projects are probably gonna be better suited for things like Twitter or Instagram or Facebook and things like that, where you can share them to the world, but you're not expecting that to be your like centerpiece, right? Another thing that's very important, man, you need to work on your thumbnails, because for instance, this is a really cool gun. This one right here looks very nice. The modeling looks really clean. Textures look really cool. It's a stylized, right? Cartoonish, but it's a good model. Yeah, poly count is decent. It's a little bit, it's a subdivision modeling, so we're not expecting like optimized game topology, but everything looks clean. Everything looks good. The only thing is when we see the, when we see the thumbnail, we just see the barrel and says my model right there. So presentation, like the thumbnail presentation, is really, really important. You should spend a good amount of time on the thumbnails to make sure that you get your character, like, present your character in the best possible way. And here's the thing. This is a very important one. I'm actually going to use, I don't like using a lot of my stuff to showcase things, but in this case, I think it's worth it. For this character right here, there's a lot of work involved on the body and on the hands and everywhere, and we thought about using this like main picture as the thumbnail, but cutting things and leaving certain things like unknown or hidden can sometimes be more beneficial to your element, because people are gonna click it because they want to see the full character, right? So in this case, we have this portrait shot, and when you go in here, you see the portrait and then you see the main body, right? So that's the kind of stuff that I recommend for these two guys right there, like a close-up of the character, which is close to what you have. But for other things like this one right here, it is definitely better to catch the whole object. Like this thumbnail right here, I would say this image right here would be the best one. Try to do a square render for this one, and you're gonna get an even better thumbnail for your projects. And then we get to the cool stuff. So, I'm not saying that the previous one were not cool, but these are like the big hitters for you, right? We got this creature right here, which is like from Gears of War, right? If I'm not mistaken, or something like that. This looks really nice. But again, I can see here, and you're saying here, that it is an assignment. It was a class. So from a sculpting perspective, it looks very good, especially here in the chest area. I think you did an amazing job. But here in the back, it does look like you either ran out of time or have motivation or inspiration. By the way, check my latest short video, guys, if you haven't seen it, about the inspiration. And it just looks a little bit unfinished, right? Like, it looks really cool right here, but again, if we go to the back view, it looks kind of like unfinished. So this is good, but another thing that you definitely need to do, and we've talked about this before, I actually have one YouTube video, I think, about clay render, right? Like, you need to do a clay render, and I know you can do renders, because on your next piece, which is the Wolverine, you're doing some really nice, like, lighting. So think about it this way, guys. Imagine you are preparing imagine you have one shot, like the Eminem song, right? Like, you got one shot, one opportunity to grab people's attention, right? If you spend a little bit more time, I know you guys are tired after finishing a project, I know you guys want to start something new and get inspired again, but if you spend that extra time trying to improve on the way you present your things, the results will be better. I'm not saying that they will be like exponentially or like orders of magnitude better, but they will definitely be slightly better than just doing a screen grab from ZBrush, okay? So you gotta put in the extra work. Why? Because there's someone out there that's putting in that extra work, and he will get abused, and you probably won't, because you're deciding to stop short. So it's like running a 100 meter race, and you stop at the 90 meter mark or 95 meter mark, and you don't go all the way, right? So you gotta go all the way through and keep pushing to make sure that you get the best result. That's very, very, very important. There you go, Dries Venvel, welcome to the chat, man. And yeah, the thumbnails are, this is something I actually have been learning for our YouTube channel, because it's like this new age in which we live, where there's a lot of competition and there's a lot of people offering their content. You gotta stand out, and audiences, like the audience, will only see your thumbnail briefly. You got like 1 or 2 seconds for them to see it, be interested, or make them interested in the topic, and then they'll click, right? So if you don't do that, it's very difficult to get it. So for instance, from all of this like elements right here, I would say these two are the ones that are stronger from a thumbnail perspective. This one maybe, because I'm curious to see the whole weapon, but all of the other ones are just like, I'm not gonna see them, right? Wolverine, this one's very cool, man. And Rasan has been sharing a lot of progresses on the Discord channel, by the way. We're going to link the Discord in just a bit in case you guys are not there, so you can check it out. And this is a really, really cool character. And I actually don't mind. I usually don't recommend people to upload things that are not finished, like works in progress. But in this case, since we're actually seeing the progression from the Seaver sculpture to the head, to the armor, and as long as you keep like updating this, you're gonna be, or like this is gonna be a really, really, really good piece. My advice would be to change the name here to work in progress so that people know that this is not finished. And then when you finished, upload a new one, because social media and social networks, they work with this sort of like algorithms, right? So if you upload something and then you keep updating that, it's not as strong as if you upload something new, because when you upload that new thing, that's when the like algorithm kicks in and it tries to push it to see if it's a hit. And if it's a hit, then people will see it, right? But if you update something, it's not a hit, like you probably updated this one first, it was probably not a hit. And then even if you update with really cool images right here, since it's kind of like linked to this old one, you might not get the best results, okay? So it's kind of like trying to bring back to life something that did not perform well at the beginning. So sometimes, and you see like top streamers and top like content creators doing this all the time, they will delete old content and then re-upload it with new thumbnails, new titles and things like that, to give them kind of like a second winner, a second life. So yeah, that's it for Rasan. Oh, we got this one right here. Again, this looks more like just as an exercise, a quick like sculpt of this character. I would avoid doing this. I would avoid updating or uploading things that are not finished, because your portfolio should be your presentation letter and it should always be finished work. But there we go. That's the first one right here. Let's jump now onto Robin McCurtian, I think. He says, hi, I've been doing 3D for about 2.5 years and I want to work as a modeler in VFX animation. Let's take a look. This is really nice, man. Robin from Belgium. Nice. So yeah, you can see this is a very nice portfolio because we have finished pieces. All of the pieces that we're seeing here are finished rendered texture pieces and they're really, really, really good. Let's start with, well, we're not going to go over all of them, but I just want to like take a look at this. So this one, for instance, is really good. This is excellent. Like making sure you show your process is very, very important. There was a discussion not so long ago in Twitter where there was like recruiters and like a 3D artist discussing what were the things that were important or not. And someone was saying like, oh, you should never add wireframes. No one cares about your wireframe. And then recruiters were like, no, we do care about the wireframe. We do care about the maps. So make sure to add that. Make sure to show the process, because the process allows us to understand and see how you think about doing all of this 3D work. So if you're following the steps properly, then that tells us that you are an artist that knows his deals, and that's the kind of stuff that they're looking for. This is really good. I would say the topology on this one's a little bit like squished on this area. There's probably ways to relax a little bit more, but in general, this looks really, really nice, Robin. Now I'm gonna jump to some like newer elements, because that one was from a year ago. This one I don't love. I think this one is, especially the render, it looks very flat. I'll probably go for a little bit more exaggerated render. The character and everything else is great. I love these breakdowns. Really, really, really cool to see the process. So yeah, you can see here on the render, the render is a little bit more like, we got this like very cool rim light on this side, very nice like soft warm light coming from this side. So matching things a little bit better on the lightning side of things might have been good. Careful with the metal edge wear. I think you're making the mistake. I always correct or fix this mistake for you guys. Metal edge wear is a great tool to add detail to your textures, but it should not be everywhere. And you can see it. You probably can see it on the concept piece. Like, you're not gonna see metal edge wear in every single border. It's quite prominent on this particular asset, but it's not everywhere. This is really good, by the way. I really like it because it's like simple, but at the same time, like interesting. Let's see. Whenever I see a concept like this, I always like to go and check the concept artist. In this case, is Dewey Van. And yeah, he's got cool stuff. So I'm definitely going to follow. I like to follow this artist because whenever I'm trying to decide what to do for the next projects, it's always difficult to find good concepts. This guy has some really, really cool stuff. So here's a pro tip, guys. If you find the concept that you really like this one right here. I really like this like dryad sort of like wire thing. Just message the artist. Like you literally just go here. You go to the guy right here, and you go to message. You can do business or general. I recommend general because it's a little bit more friendly. Sometimes business gets a filter only, and you're like, "Hey, Dewey. Hey, Dewey. I really liked your dryad character design. Would it be okay for me to try to model it in 3D? Let me know if that's okay." And then just thank you. Love your art. And that's it. Now, he might answer, he might not answer. But that's fine. At least you got now you got a new connection. And if he gives you the blessing, then what's the word? If you get the blessing to use the artwork, then when you finish the artwork, he might even help you share it around. And that's another way to make connections. So yeah, don't be afraid to just like talk to people. I remember I was very scared of doing that when I was first starting. Like you always feel like a little bit like fish out of the water, right? Like, should I do it? Should I not do it? Just do it. Like, what's the worst thing that can happen? They're not going to answer. That's it. Or they're going to say, no, I don't want you to do 3D. Okay. Then you move on to someone else. So yeah, don't be afraid of asking. So otherwise you're not going to be able to find out what's going on. Cool. So yeah, Robin, I think all of these things are really good except for this little goblin wire. And I remember seeing it on the Discord. It was like, it's a cool idea. The textures are really well executed, but the concept itself, I don't love it. The little butt right there. I don't love the goblin itself. This axe is fine. It's a little bit high poly. This could be like for cinematics or something, for like a movie. It's just the design of the character that I don't particularly like, to be honest. That's a great 3D print, by the way. But everything else is really good. So if I had to tell you something, I would probably just take the goblin out because, again, I personally don't love it. But every single other things are very, very nice. This one, it's amazing. Mexican truck, food truck. Oh, that's oh, you did this for the Endless Engines Challenge. That's nice, man. Yeah, that's really cool. Yeah, this is a great one, man. And from what I can see here, yeah, the concept is really nice. Yeah, so my best advice for you, Robin, I think the only thing you're missing is a more organic character, and your portfolio would be like completely round off. So like a normal human, female character, male character. You can even do stylized characters, that's fine. I know you did one right here, but he's like relatively small. So that way you would have weapons, robots, vehicles, like everything. So yeah, this is really, really good work, man. Really good work. Cool, let's move to the next one. So the next one is from Nilesh Jaiswar. He says, "Hello, sir, I've been doing 3D for about 2 years plus, and I want to work as a 3D character artist in gaming studios. Here's my portfolio." Let's take a look. Okay, so first things I see, there are, again, incomplete pieces or simple pieces that might not be ideal to have on our portfolio because we tend to think that having more pieces is better, and sometimes that's not ideal. We got a question here from The Hidden. It says, "Abe, do you recommend putting some character art on the same page as, let's say, Asset Weapons, or would it be better to create a new page for it?" I personally like keep everything on the same page. I know some people like to, like move them around. I just keep everything on the same page because I mean, I'm not a recruiter, right? But I know that it can be a little bit inconvenient to be navigating from folder to folder. So I just have everything on the same place. So environments, props, characters, vehicles, everything. However, I mean, again, your mileage may vary. So let's take a look at this. He has a Thyros. He is a proud owner of the Thyros course. And Nilesh, you did a good job capturing most of the things. There are some anatomy issues. The face especially looks a little bit wonky, but I admire the fact that you were able to complete the whole process, because it's not an easy process to follow, to do the retopology, texturing, everything. It's a good process. However, for character, I think we still need to go back to basics. So my best advice for you, Nilesh, is to go and do a male anatomy study. Just a clay study, not a crochet. Just try to do a mannequin, like a male mannequin, and go through all of the muscles, all of the proportions. Because, for instance, one of the things that I see here on the arms is that you're making the wrist very, very, very small. So he has this huge shoulders, huge biceps, and then very, very thin arms right here. I actually, I brought my tablet here to do some paintovers. So let's do this. Sanimation, welcome, man. Welcome, my friend. There we go. Okay. So, when we're doing characters, again, anatomy is really, really important. It's not the like the most important thing, but it is important. So over here, let's make this a little bit bigger. Here's where we will have the shoulder, okay, the deltoid muscle, which has this sort of like shape right here. Here's the bicep, which is nice. You did a good job here on the bicep. Here's the tricep on the back, which you also did a good job right there. But here you are missing one very, very important muscle, a pair of muscles actually, that are called the extensor carpi radialis longus endobrachioradialis. Those two. Very complex names. By the way, we cover this on our latest course on the demon character creation course. We go over a lot of anatomy. But these muscles actually start right here in the middle of the arm, and they are the ones that give the silhouette to the arm. And they roll around, okay, they roll around to the front of the hand, like this, okay? So you're gonna see a big bulge here on this part of the arm. That's why when you draw an arm, again, this is like shoulder, this is like the bicep, and then you have this sort of like triangular looking shape going into the hand, right? So this point right here and this point right here are very important for the silhouette of the arm, and you're missing a little bit of that information right there. These are called the flexors and the extensors. They are the muscles that move the fingers up and down. And that's the kind of stuff that we're missing here on some of the elements. The hands also look a little bit small for, again, for this like big character that we have right here. But just like fixing those little anatomy issues could potentially make this character a little bit better. Now, for these weapons right here, these ones, again, never, my advice to everyone watching right now, never, ever, 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 ever upload a screenshot from the software. It's so wrong. Like, it feels so wrong to do it. This is the kind of screenshots that you upload to your Facebook stories or to Instagram or to Twitter or something, but never upload a screenshot of your software as your final portfolio piece. Why not? Because, for instance, in ZBrush, you're one click away from doing a VPR, which is gonna give you a slightly better render. Nowadays, Redshift is included in ZBrush, so you have no excuses to do a render that looks bad, right? So this axe looks good. This is a good weapon. I would say it's a decent one. You can definitely make this into a game asset. And even though there's a couple of like things here and there that will probably change from a sculpting perspective or from a sculpting standpoint, like the brush strokes that you see here on the wood grain, it's not a bad weapon. However, it's badly presented. And bad presentation hurts us so, 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 so much. I'm not sure if you guys have experienced this, but here in Mexico, for instance, there's a lot of taco stands, right? It's like, we love tacos. It's not unknown to the world that in Mexico we're famous for our tacos. And sometimes you go to very sketchy taco stands, like they look horrible. Everything's just like a mess. And then you taste those tacos and you're like, these are the best tacos I've ever had, right? And this happens all over the world with like food stands and things like that. Now, imagine if that stand was just a little bit better presented. Like a good presentation and good product, that's like your key to being like way more successful, right? So it's very, very, very important to present things in the best possible way. Let's see, Harshit, how many profiles are you going? All of them. I'm going to review all of the ones that were submitted for the portfolio review here for August. So if you submitted in this last couple of hours, I'm going to be checking yours. So far, we've checked Robin McEarthian, Rayson Topobropto, and that's it. Just two. This is the third one. This is the third one that we're watching right now. So here's another thing. Your cover page, it does not match what we're seeing right here. I can see two of the pieces. I'm not seeing this character girl over here. So we definitely need to work on that. And again, Nalesh, try to see which ones of this are worth doing a render. I would say the axe is worth the render. This shield is worth a render. These headphones are really cool. They're worth a render. But a good render, man. You need to do a good render because right now this is not... You're not presenting yourself or you're selling yourself short, right? So if you present this with a good render, make sure to check our YouTube channel. We have one video about specifically presentation. You're going to be able to get more points for yourself. Let's go now to... That was Natash. This one is Harshit. He says, oh, that's you, Harshit. You're next. Hello, sir. I've been your fan of teaching for many years. The way you teach it really helps me learn new things. Keep teaching and inspire us. Here's my portfolio. Let's take a look. Nice. Okay, so Harshit here is an excellent example of what I was just mentioning. Presentation. The way you present things will drive people to interact with your portfolio in this case. So first things that I say, nice presentation, clean final or finished or finalized products. So this is good. I like it. However, I'm going to say one thing. It's very dark. You're going for relatively dark renders. And if there's one thing we've learned recently, right, Sarn, is that people don't react to dark, contrasty things as much as they do to light things. So you might want to like switch it around. Sometimes you're going to have light like renders. Sometimes you're going to have dark renders. That's fine. But switch it around because especially a lot of people are watching their content on their other phones. And sometimes they're watching the content with the brightness all the way down. Remember, it's very uncomfortable to have the brightness all the way up on your phone. So if they do that, they're not going to see anything. They're just going to see like the glowy bits, the shiny bits, and that's not good. Now, from all of these points, Harshit, I'm seeing two pieces are standing out that I would probably take out. This hand right here and this bottle guy right here. Let me tell you why. So on this glove right here, you did something that's called a post-production thing. You took the concept, you did the render of the glove, and then you added the image on the background. It looks fake. It doesn't look like the glove is inside of this image. In this particular case, either you have to model the whole background so that it looks like the glove is there, or just don't have a background. Just do a basic white clean background, like a clay render sort of background, and that's going to be good because this asset's not bad. I do see a couple of issues here on the cables. They look a little bit too flat. Like the light in general, I think looks a little bit too flat on this glove. So I would probably take that glove out of your portfolio, especially because it's on the centerpiece of your portfolio. So this is like you see your face, we see your face, we see your name, and then this is like one of the first ones that I'm seeing, and it's not great. So you probably want to move this little guy over here and make sure that it matches. Again, I don't like doing this too much, but when I plan out the layout for my portfolio, I try to make sure that all of the important bits are like easy to remember. So that's why I have like the Diablo centerpiece right here, because you see my face, you see my name, and you see the Diablo piece. And you want to try to organize things in such a way that you always like capture the attention of the audience. This little robot right here, I like the robot. It's a simple, cute robot, but the render is not working on this one. So to be honest, I think I would prefer to see something like this, like just a robot by itself. Maybe do a texture pass so that you get some nice results for this one. And just ignore the bottle and the other environment. Like this sort of fog, I'm going to guess that you added this fog as a post-processing thing in Photoshop or something. Like, I don't think this is like real fog on the scene. And it's just not helping, right? So just be careful here. Like, you don't want to do... this is another, like, one pro tip that I always give you guys. When you're deciding what piece to do, and I think I'm going to do... I've been wanting to do a video. Let me know in the chat if I should do this video. I've been trying to do a video of how to pick a good project. And I think here that was the mistake. Like, the project that we picked was not the best project for this kind of presentation. Now, this one is really good. I really like this robot. Let's just wait for this thing to do it. Yeah, Yeah, so this robot right here, Harshit, this one's really good. And even though it's simple, it's a good effect. Again, don't do this. This is a I used to do that a lot in some of my older pieces, like Sparks and Fire. It's not necessary, okay? It's not necessary. It hurts your element. This clean render, that's all you need. That's all you want. However, there's one very important thing about this one right here, and that's the metal edgeware again. So you can see again, Harshit, you have this error or this problem where every single edge, no matter where it is, has the same amount, the same amount of metal edgeware as everything else. And in real life, when things get damaged, they don't get damaged uniformly across all of the surfaces. So you're gonna have more damage in areas that are more exposed to the environment. For instance, I would expect the feet to be really damaged, but maybe these inner parts right here, not to be as damaged. You got two options here. There's a video that I recorded not so long ago about how to do proper metal edgeware, and you can just add a paint layer and paint out some of the metal edgeware so that you recover the original material and it doesn't look as uniform. That's gonna, again, it's those little details. There's a famous quote that says the devil's on the details, right? So it's those little details that allow you to generate something that's a little bit nicer. Now, how to pick a project and actually complete it. That's a good video, definitely. We'll add that to the list. This dinosaur, I love dinosaurs, and this one is really, really, really cool. I think this is probably one of your best pieces. The only issue is that it's very dark, so I would love to see this character on a slightly lighter scene so that we can appreciate it. And I saw that you did another one, this one right here. This one I don't think is as successful because it has this like weird cables and the mat looks a little bit like, I don't know, wonky. But one of the things that you could do is you could combine both of the robots and have a single scene with them, okay? This shield is really good. I like it. It's a little bit thick on the thick side. This one seems to be a little bit more low poly. There you go. I know that one. We have a tutorial on YouTube, guys. If you guys want to learn how to make this shield, there's a tutorial. It's like a three-part videos or series where we do this shield right here. And there you go. Welcome, my friend. So if you want to check our YouTube channel, that's all of this information is right there. Now Harshit is asking here on the chat some examples, right? So let's say we look for robot concept arts. Whenever I pick a concept art, I like to divide the concept arts into really easy, like intermediate, and really advanced, right? And I need to ask myself, how much time am I going to dedicate to this project? Is it going to be 1 week? Is it going to be 2 weeks? Is it going to be 6 months? Like, depending on the time that you're going to be spending on something, that's kind of like the complexity that I want to go for. So let's say we're going to go for like an intermediate one. We're going to spend maybe 1 or 2 months working on it to get like a really, really nice portfolio piece. In those cases, I'm going to immediately like disqualify any robot that's way too complex, like this thing right here. Like, that's way too much. I'm just gonna spend like 2 weeks just modeling all of these things, and it's gonna be impossible to complete. So that's not a project that you're gonna be doing by yourself. And actually, if you think about this, this sort of robots like Transformers and things like that, it's a whole team. Like, there's a whole team doing like Optimus Prime. It's not a single artist usually that's gonna do the whole thing. Or there might be one guy that's gonna do the full modeling, but there's gonna be another one that's gonna do the UVs, and another one's gonna be the textures. So in a big production, you're not expected to do absolutely everything, right? So again, looking for some like cool concepts, something like this, maybe this is a little bit hard because of all of the components, but it could be something a little bit closer. I guess this one is actually really good. So as you can see, this one has a lot of like very blocky shapes. Yes, there's connections and things like that, but it should be doable in like a 1 month, 2 month time frame, okay? You don't want to go super simple though, like this sort of things right here. This tend to be quite simple. I've seen a lot of like this cute robots, like this one's right here. And these ones are fine for like a 1 week exercise or like 2 week exercises. But here's the thing, since they're relatively simple to do, it's difficult to compete against things that are a little bit more complex. So that's why you always want to try to find the projects that are, you want to find the projects that are good to the objective that you have. So this is one of the things that I'm going to mention on this video that I'm going to record, because I definitely think it's going to be useful. I would say there's three types of projects in general: learning projects, portfolio projects and passion projects, okay? So learning projects are projects that you're gonna do to learn something. So if you wanna learn anatomy, you're gonna be doing a character and you wanna learn anatomy while you do the character. Portfolio projects should not be for learning. Portfolio projects should be for executing. You wanna show or you wanna demonstrate that you know your stuff and you're gonna pick a project that's gonna allow you to show that sort of stuff. And passion projects are projects that you do just for, because you want to do it. You're not trying to prove anything. You're not trying to, you might wanna, you might learn during that process, but it's just, you found the concept, you thought it was cool, but it might not be a portfolio project. You just wanna do the project. So for instance, this guy right here, this looks very, very cool. So I could do this as a passion project. I'm not gonna use it in my portfolio, probably. I'm not gonna use it for like a class or anything, but I just like the concept. It looks cool and I just wanna do it, right? So depending on what kind of project you're using or going for, and depending how much time you want to spend on it, that's the kind of concept that you're going to be selecting. Another, I actually did a short not so long ago about this, and another thing that's very important is you need to try to find a concept that's very clear, okay? So unfortunately, there's a lot of concept art, like let's say this one right here. If you take a look at this and you're like, oh yeah, I want to do it, it looks super cool. Yeah, it might look very cool, but it's very, very complex, and there's not a lot of information. So if you have a question about how things work, you're not gonna be able to solve that question and you might spend more time trying to figure it out than like actually working on the thing, right? So yeah, that's it, my friend. That would be my advice. If you have more questions, let me know here in the chat and I'll be happy to answer. That was Harshit. Harshit Tiwari. Now we go with Sasuke. Hello, sir. I'm a 3D prop artist and here's my portfolio. Please guide me by review. Let's take a look. Okay, so first things first, again, I see a couple of incompleted elements or again, things that I would call simple assets that are not worthy of being on your portfolio. For instance, this headset right here is not a difficult headset. It's just a cylinder, a couple of cables and the plugs. So this is the kind of stuff that anyone can do as long as you learn the basics of 3D, right? The render is not great, but it's not bad either. Again, I will probably take this one out. This one's really cool. This one was from a fellow instructor back at Nextut, and he did the series, and it was a really good series. And I think this is a good result. I do see a couple of things here going on with the bakes, especially your corners are very like chewed. So you might want to check that. Make sure to check this one as well. Like we're not smoothing something on the high poly or on the low poly, and that's where we're getting this faceting. But in general, this is a good prop. Like as a small prop, I could find it. The texture here, careful there. You can see a little bit of stretching there on the UVs. So we gotta be very careful with those details. I think you also should spend a little bit more time on the sculpting part of this, like cushion pads, and this one's right here, so it looks a little bit more like cushion, like actual cushion. The topology is fine. So this is a good asset. I would definitely keep this one on your portfolio. This one's really good. This barricade, it might seem simple, but it's a really good one. And I can see that you were using, or at least thinking about the metal edgeware by making it not be everywhere. So this is a great, great asset. This is the kind of stuff that you're gonna find in games and stuff. My advice for this piece, because it's again a simple piece, is try to add more things. Try to add like a traffic cone, try to add like, I don't know, like those little things that they place where they find like bullet casings and things like that. So all of those, like if you make a little scene with just simple assets, it elevates the asset that you currently have and it makes something that looks a little bit better. So that's the kind of stuff that you wanna be going for, right? Like you wanna be able to tell a story with the assets that you're creating. In this case, is for Pankaj. This character head. I mean, I understand what you're going for. This sort of like stylized cartoon. This is not portfolio ready, so just take it out. And this one right here, this one's actually a little bit better. I think your anatomy is getting there. Your hands still need a lot of work. I will probably take this one out as well. But if you really want to keep it because you want to show that you want to do characters, at least again, do a clay render so that you can get a nicer result on your portfolio. This knife is fine. It's a little bit low poly. This axe is better. I actually like this axe better. I'll probably change the thumbnail so that the axe is the one on the top. Again, careful with the metal edgeware. It's everywhere on some of these parts right here. And very important, I know we have the marmoset viewer, but if you can include some wireframe renders, that's going to give you extra points for this one as well. But again, be careful with simple things, guys. If you, I usually say this, if you can finish a project in a day, it's probably not worthy of portfolio. And the reason is, unless you're like a super master and you can do amazing things in just one day, good things take time. So you need to spend time to make sure that you can get the best things out there. Okay. Harshid is asking, there are many which I have planned to start and there are many which were never finished. This one's a big problem. Yeah. Starting and finishing projects is one of those things that we as artists tend to struggle quite a bit with. I'll probably do another video about talking about that. But yeah, I understand your frustration, man. Let's see. It says, Hey Abe, I just started my first job in the industry as a texture artist at a small studio. Currently, I model, sculpt, and texture. However, I want to head into the line of look dev and texturing in the future. I would love to hear some feedback. Let's see. This is Anshit Jain. I'm guessing Anshit's a relatively common name. Okay, cool. Cool. So, again, I see some cool pieces. Like, this robot's really good. The beer mug is nice. This Anton Eagle, I don't love it. This one is really good. The EPL logo. Expressions. Let's take a look at this. Are this just like, is it like an animation? Okay, it's an animation. It's not bad, but again, unless you want to be an animator, usually the advice is don't upload something that you don't want to do. So if you upload animation, you might get animation offers, and if you don't want to do it, then it's going to be a little bit awkward, right? This one's really good. I really like this one. Jewelry. Yeah. Yeah, this is nice. That's nice. I guess... Well, sorry. This is one of your top pieces, this sort of like goblin guy. This one's really good. I think the bump is a little bit too big in certain areas. We need to play a little bit with the light. I understand what you were going for. I think you saturated a lot of the red colors a little bit too much on the front of the face. The sculpt is not bad, although I do see a couple of like anatomy things that I would fix, like the nasolabial folder. I feel like it's looking a little bit weird on the underside. You can see how it usually puffs out a little bit more on this area right here. But it's a good sculpt. In this one, something that will be very important is to see the topology to make sure that we have animation ready topology. That way we can evaluate a little bit better if we got the proper things. This one's from the intro to Maya. Was it the intro to Maya scene? I think so. Yeah. I mean, again, these are exercises, and usually I don't recommend exercises to be on your main portfolio. But in this case, you presented them in a nice way. And yeah, I remember you were doing this Kratos. I think you shared this on the Discord channel as well. It's proportions are off. They're definitely off. The face of the character, some of the nasolabial folds, and again, it's a little bit tricky. And likeness, like trying to capture the likeness of a character, is always like challenging. It's not the easiest thing to do. Yeah, I would probably take this one out, to be honest. I think you have some really strong pieces like the goblin and some of these other ones like the jewelry. That keeping this one might hurt you a little bit more than it might help you. So my advice would be probably to remove that one. Cool. Let's move to the next one. This is Nithin Skure from India. Okay, so again, first things that we see here in Nithin's portfolio is that we have a lot of pieces, but some of them are relatively simple pieces, like this guitar right here. The guitar is not bad, but it does look a little bit low poly, and it looks like a very blocky thing. So, it says here that it's supposed to be the Last of Us guitar. I don't see it as the Last of Us guitar. I would probably keep this one out of the portfolio. This classroom looks good, but here we're making one very, very common mistake. And I'm guessing, Nathan, I'm not sure if you're here in the chat, but I'm guessing, Nathan, that you are using Eevee instead of Cycles. For this kind of scenes, for this sort of like renders, you always want to try to use Cycles. And one of the reasons this is, you can see the shadows right here. Look at how sharp and like fake the shadows look. If you just turn on Cycles, you're gonna get the exact same scene, but it's gonna look 10 times better because the shadows are gonna give you a more realistic look. You're gonna get realistic fall off and everything. Another thing that I would probably recommend for this scene is some depth of field. Depth of field, I think we've done some, I'm not sure if we've done a video recently about depth of field, but I might have to do one, a new one soon. And the depth of field is this thing that we can do with cameras where we blur the background and blur the foreground and we keep the focus on something specific. So who or what is the most important part here in this scene? Is it the desk? Is it the teacher's desk? Like, try to tell a story in how you build these scenes so that you can get a better result. Same thing for this one. Like, I like the scene. I like what you're going for. I can see that you're using emissive here on the screen, which looks good. However, one of the issues is that the light that we're getting is a very, very, very fake light, and that just like kills the whole scene, okay? I also can like see that the materials that you're using are very basic materials, probably just like blender materials. You wanna try to texture some of these things so that you get a little bit more variation, because otherwise it's gonna look very CG. It's gonna look kinda like how Toy Story looked back in the 90s, right? And nowadays, with all of the technology that we have available, there's no reason for our renders to look like this. Modeling wise, I could also recommend a little bit more complexity on your objects, because a lot of the objects that I'm seeing right now are relatively simple. This one's good. This one's a little bit better. The height is a little bit too strong, but it's better presented. For you, my friend, since you want to do game art and game design, I would strongly recommend you check our first course, which was the Blender X creation course. In that one, we go over the whole process and I talk about presentation, renderings, everything. But I can definitely see the progress. Like, this one's looking a little bit better. The stitching might be a little bit too much. I feel like it's a little bit too big. Usually you don't have stitches like that. And right now it's very washed out. Like this scene right here, it's a little bit overexposed, I would say, because we're seeing a lot of line going into the scene. And you gotta be very careful with how you present your work. Again, we've mentioned this several times in this stream already. Presentation, how you like show your work is gonna be super important. So look at how much wasted space we have over here. And over here, this is one of the shots where duplicate this like briefcase or this case and just like have one facing us and then one facing the floor like this, and that way you're gonna be using more like screen real estate and get a better result. I can see that you're not beveling your edges as much. Like, everything looks very like edgy and hard edge. Be very careful there, because that could potentially cause some issues, especially on the bakes. You can see them right there on the UVs. There's some like cuts on the elements. This, I'm not sure. I would need to see the exact model of the gun. It's not bad, but if you've gone into ArtStation, you know the competition, especially for guns, is very, very, very complex. So, not bad in general, Nathan. However, one of the advices that I would give you is try to do something a little bit more complex, because from all of these pieces that we've seen here, the most complex one would be probably the revolver and this one right here. Everything else is a model that you can do, again, in like a day or two. And for portfolio, you always want to showcase your best possible work. A car is always a good test to see if you really know your stuff. But there's other things that you can do, like more complex guns, sci-fi guns, steampunk, things like that. It's always a good option as well. Cool, so that was Nathan. Let's now go with Shavin. Says, Shavin, hey Abe, I'm just finishing my graduation in animation and VFX. I would like to be a 3D generalist in the industry. I posted 3 projects in ArtStation that I have done. Let's take a look. Nice, okay. This one looks really nice, really clean. Gourmet popcorn. I would probably push the light a little bit more. I don't love the popcorns. I've not seen this one, so they might look like that. To be honest, this is a nice shot. Just add more light. It looks a little bit dull right now. Actually, let me... I don't have Photoshop open. But yeah, like adding just a little bit more light might be a good idea for this one. This one's good because of the dark colors, but I would still push the light a little bit more. Same for this one. Just push the light a little bit more. These things, by the way, guys, these things that you're seeing here from Shavin, companies are paying so much money for this sort of stuff, for this sort of like renders and things. Well, not like super, not super big amounts, but they pay way more than you would think. I'm going to give you an example. Like if someone, like if a local gourmet popcorn asked me to do this sort of renders for them, it would probably take me like one day to finish this project. And I would at least charge them like $300. like at least. And it's not a lot of work from a technical side of things. It's not that difficult once you know these things. And $300 is quite a lot of money to get in like 1 or 2 days, right? Well, it depends on where you live, right? Here in Mexico, $300 is quite a bit. So yeah, that's the thing. Advertisement, like 3D4 advertisement, there's so much work out there. So my advice is always keep your mind open to those possibilities as well. Same thing here, too dark. It's way too dark, man. I can't see anything. I'm not sure how the columns are made. I'm not sure how the texture is done. It's way, way, way too dark. So you either need to show some like progress shots of the different assets that you were using on this scene, or lighten up the scene, because this is way, way too dark. I will probably not use this one, to be honest. Like, I understand what you were going for, but it's just way, way too dark. Yeah, I don't love this one either. It looks very basic. Like the snake, not great. You can see like that cut right there. It kind of looks like you just went into ZBrush, did the selection, and then deleted the faces because it's like a one-sided element. You need to be a little bit more careful in how you construct things, because this is not great. And it is really interesting. And this is again why the portfolio is so important, especially for recruiters. When you see a portfolio like this, and you see like a really good product development and design like this one right here, and then you see two other pieces that are like a little bit meh, dubious, then you start to question, and I'm not trying again to be mean, I'm just being very realistic. You're like, why was this really good and this one's not as good, right? Like you need to try to keep your portfolio to the best possible level. I've shown you this guy this before, guys, here. So on my portfolio, I got a lot of stuff that is unpublished, and I'm still deciding whether or not I'm going to publish it, because I don't feel like all of this are like worth it for my portfolio. That doesn't mean that I haven't shared them. For instance, Thyros, I've shared Thyros before. This one's probably going to be published, but this one right here, for instance, like I got several renders and things that are like cool renders. Like the question is, do I want to really have this on my portfolio, or were they just like cool renders that I did? They're probably just cool renders. So this one right here might not be in my portfolio. You don't need to upload everything to your portfolio. So try to keep your portfolio only for your best stuff. Cool. Let's go now with the next one. That was Shaveen. We go with Dryce. Says, hello, I've been doing 3D for around 3 years. My goal is to work as a character artist, and I'm not sure if my portfolio is up to par to work in the industry at the moment. Let's take a look. Dryce Benamar Belkeman from Belgium. Nice, yeah, I've seen this one. You shared this one on the Discord channel. From a first like glance, you do have some nice stuff. Motion tracking plus animation test. What were you animating? Oh, the little spider right there. Okay, animation could be a little bit better. Render could also be a little bit better. She looks a little bit like the spider looks a little bit washed out. The motion tracking is fine though. So yeah, I think for you, man, if you want to be a character artist, the best advice that I can give you is to try to do a full realistic character, learning all the proper like muscles and proportions. Because I can see here, for instance, that you do understand the topology flow that you need to follow. That's good. But we need to work a little bit more on the proper anatomy. And I can see it on this one right here. You do know where most of the things here, you have this very like blobby sort of like inflated stylized effect, which is fine. I think you could benefit quite a bit, my friend Driss, if you haven't checked our newest course, the Demon Character course, the ZBrush for character artists. That one, I think, fits your style, and it will give you a clearer look or view on the anatomy things that you need to like capture on your characters. This face is really good. My advice would be to try to finish the whole body. There's a couple of places that are a little bit weird. You need to clean up your form a little bit more as well. Like all of this brush strokes that we're seeing, you're not supposed to see that, okay? So use your trim dynamic, for instance, to flatten that thing out and get rid of some of those lines, because I saw it on this one right here. I'm not sure, it kind of looks to me that for this character, you used poly paint instead of like a traditional texture painting, because it looks very, kind of like very obvious of the like the cavity masks and things like that. So we definitely need to clean up the forms. It's really cool that you were able to rig it. Rigging is always like complicated, but there's things that can definitely be improved. Oh, you did use substance painter. Okay, then my advice, man, would be try to be a little bit softer on the cavity mask or the dirt mask, because it looks very intense right here. You can add a blur filter for some of them as well to try to soften them up a little bit more. You have this very cartoon style, which is fine. If you were gonna do cartoon stylized characters, that's great. But we do gotta clean the forms a little bit more. Like this, like fins that you have here, you have something similar on the fish guy. They look a little bit like lumpy, right? So those are the kind of things that I would probably just like model in Blender or in Maya and just have like really clean, sharp lines. If you've seen like fins from fishes, they tend to be very, very clean, very, very like tight. But again, the fact that you rigged it, this is very, very important, because not a lot of people rig their characters. So being able to see the character fully rigged and moving, that shows that you are getting there. My advice, especially because that's what you were asking on the message, like, do you have what it takes to be a character artist? I would say for a small studio, yes, you have all of the knowledge that you would require, but we do need to see like a traditional male character and a traditional female character. Those are like go to like a soldier, a knight, a paladin, a I don't know, like a fighter, a something, just like a male character, like a full male character and a full female character. Ideally, you want them to be either realistic or with a very like specific art style, so that people can be like, oh, I need a cartoon character artist, I'm gonna call Driss. Yeah, blur filter is really good, back boy, inside of Substance. Cool, so that was Driss. That's now we're gonna go with Ghost. Says, hi, I do environment and props. I have been learning by my own for the past 1.5 years. I would love to get some feedbacks on where I can improve and learn new things. Thank you. Let's take a look. Ooh, nice. This is cool. Okay. Nice. See, this looks like a really cool environment piece, and one of the things that really like makes it pop is the amount of stuff, right? Now, I'm guessing, or I want to guess, that not all of the stuffs here were made by yourself. Like, you probably, like the trees and things like that, you downloaded them, like EB generators, things like that. And that's fine. I can see some speed tree right there. That's great. Be very careful with the details. Remember, the devil's on the details, right? So, for instance, one of the things that I noticed is that the trees are pretty much just like ingrained into the ground. Usually trees will have a little bit of a dirt like patch around them so that they can grow a little bit more. Same for that tree right there, it's right in the middle of the street. So be careful with those details. And here on the potted plants, just add a simple circle and add a dirt texture, because right now they're just going like straight into the pot and it makes it look a little bit weird. Careful here on the brick wall. This is very important. This applies to everyone, by the way, my friends. If you're doing this, if you're doing brick walls will usually have a little bit of silhouette on this side right here. So either use displacement to really push that, or model just a couple of bricks and push them on the side so that we don't have this like super straight line. That's one like dead giveaway about the 3D art. If you have like perfect 90 degree lines or perfect straight lines, that tends to be a bad idea for believability or like realism. And you can look like all around, I'm looking around my office here, and not like I don't have any wall that's like perfectly 90 degrees straight. There's always like a little bit of variation. So by changing that, you're gonna be able to get a slightly different effect. But that was 2 years ago. That environment was 2 years ago. I can see that this one was more recent, last year. This one's really good. I think, is this the, I'm not sure if this is the challenge. Pixar did a challenge a couple of months ago with RenderMan. So I'm not sure if the models are from that challenge or if you modeled everything. No, it says that you did texturing only. So yeah, the model was, I guess I've seen this model before, this kitchen model. But this is really good texturing. Look at the detail of Surya right here. He managed to create a very, very nice transition. Very cool, like old effect. The metal edgeware, notice how the metal edgeware is not everywhere. We have a very nice effect going around the whole things. Light is good as well. So yeah, this is a really, really good project. If you did texture everything, like if you texture every single asset that you're seeing right here,
I would personally like to see more assets like this, like this stove right here. Like, I want to see how you texture, like, I don't know, the fridge, how you texture some of the cabinets, how you texture, like, the garlics, for instance. The garlics look great. So that would be my main question. Like, if you did texture everything, show it, show the work, especially because you said here texturing only, and you want to try to engage. Like, I always try to write at least a little bit of the explanation of what I'm doing here, so that people can ask questions and things like that. So for this one in particular, that will be my question. Like, how many of these assets did you texture? Which I'm guessing all of them. And just show me more of those assets. Let me see more of that work, because that's a really, really good project. This one right here is very fun. Concept by Bruce Yu. Very nice. Very clean. Very, very clean. It's sort of like a Japanese shotgun. It does... Oh, nice. It's a great shotgun. A great concept. Looks really nice. Yeah, I think you nailed the concept very, very nicely. The only thing I'm not concerned, but the fact is I do more games than film these days. Or than commercials. So I always try to see how this will look in the game. And this is, of course, not optimized. But you did a great job on this one, man. Great, great job. Even managed to do something similar there for the pattern. Yeah, so this one's a really, really, really good weapon. A really nice presentation as well. It's great. This one's a little bit more stylized. Very cool as well. Nice. Again, this is not optimized. This one looks a little bit more optimized. Very good, man. Very good. And then this one. Nice. I will probably lower the glossiness of the tape just a little bit. I know this kind of tape tends to be a little bit more shiny than others. But this looks good. It's like a harpoon, right? Spear gun, yeah. Yeah, this is really damn good. This is what I mean by attention to detail, my friends. And this is what I was mentioning earlier today. It's like, can you imagine how long this took to make? Like, this is not something that you do in one day. It takes weeks to do something like this, probably. Because it's a really nice attention to detail on the model, and it's a really nice attention to detail on the textures. And look at the presentation, look at how many renders Asuria is submitting here for us to appreciate every single part of the weapon. Yeah, this is a great one, man. Yeah, I'm not sure if you already have a job, but you got everything that you need. Like, you're perfectly good to be working on any production, to be honest. I guess my only recommendation for you, my friend, would be to do like a robot, like a cool robot. I think that could be good, or like a ship, like something a little bit bigger, because I see a lot of props, like simple, like small props, like the axe, the weapons right here. So doing something big and complex to showcase that you can tackle those kind of elements might be a good option as well. Great job, by the way. This one looks very cool as well. Yeah. Sorry, I'm a little bit sleepy. Yeah, because even like normally I recommend renderings and things like that, but you really nailed it here. So congratulations, man. Really cool stuff. Cool. Let's go with Sick Boy Shashank. Says, I want to be a good character artist. Recently, I completed one character from scratch. It has 38,000 triangles. Please give me feedback on which area I should improve. Thank you. And here's the link. Okay. So Shashank is from India as well. And we got this sword right here. I think I've seen this one before. I'm not sure if you've submitted it before. The Chaos Sword. Modeling is not bad. Like the sculpting and the modeling is not bad. I don't love the textures. They look very plasticky. They kind of look like a toy sword. So I'll probably play around with those a little bit more, so that you can get some more realistic textures. Maleface. Yeah, it's a good study. I would probably not have this Maleface on my portfolio. Whenever you're doing faces, one advice that I give my students is never do a face with just the neck. Looks very weird. Kind of looks like a... don't know, like a thumb or something. So always add the a little bit of the shoulder muscles, and then you can cut it out. So something like this, like a t-shirt cut or something. That's usually a little bit better for characters, because otherwise it just looks like a, I don't know, like a worm or something. It's very weird. Let's see. Mentioning being able to work on any production, would you say I'll be a fit for a small studio or something, even for beginner level? I'm struggling to find work and I'm so looking forward to it. Always feels like my work is not enough. Yeah, I started saying industry is really hard at the moment. And the reason is, well, the world is in constant change, right? So there's things like AI and there's new softwares coming out and things like that. So it can be a little bit difficult to break into the industry. My advice, if you can afford it, is to either try to look for an unpaid internship. I don't usually recommend doing it because I know it's very punishing to work for free, but it could get you into the door and get you some experience. Like doing it at least for like a month or two might be a good idea. And the other thing is, why not try to do something yourself, like a small game, a small like little production, a small little commercial or something, and offer your services to people that might be looking for them. It's another thing that could help you get some experience as well. Let's see. This one, Warrior. This is my first character, which I created using ZBrush, Maya, and Substance Painter. 38k triangles. So anatomy is not that bad. We got some really nice forms and proportions. I do think there might be some proportions that are a little bit off, especially here on the feet.
Oh my god,
sorry. Especially here on the feet, like there's some anatomy things that I would definitely change. The skirt looks a little bit fake, same for the belt on the top. We gotta be very careful. Belts and leather, it can be tricky to do right, so be careful there. It's a good first character, however, I would still try to use all of the things that you learned on this one to try to do another one and improve a little bit more on the sculpt. I would love to see the sculpt of that character first. This one looks fun as well. It would be interesting to see him like rigged and properly like processed. There are a couple things here that wouldn't work.
This part right here usually goes forward.
What the hell? I'm falling asleep right here. So this thing is, especially like this, are like heels or like steels or something. You gotta be careful there. Like, because otherwise, when you try to rig this, this guy's not gonna be able to work. So what do I mean by this? Let me go here to Kree then. There we go. So usually we have this thing going forward, and then we go backward, and then we go forward again. And this is where you have the feet, like, or the little like fingers. Because remember, when we're comparing anatomy in the humans, we got the femur, and then we got the lower leg bones, the tibia, and the, I always forget the name of the other one in English, and in Spanish is peroné, but I don't know the name in English. And then we got the all of the ankle muscles bones, and then we got the metatarsals. And then the tarsals, which are the fingers, right? This is a human leg. In a trilateral leg, which is this one right here, you're still gonna have the femur, you're still gonna have the tibia, and then this is like the heel right here, and this become the metatarsals. So here you're adding bones, like more bones than what we have, because you got 1, 2, 3, 4, and then 5. There's no animal that I've ever seen that has this like 5 divisions right here. So what you need to do is simplify all of these points right here. They simplify into 1, and then you have the fingers right here. And this guy's kind of like walking on its tippy toes. That's animal design. There's a book that I recommend frequently. That's by Terry Witchall or something like that. She did a lot of the Avatar creatures, and she explains a lot of these things. Or there's diagrams on the book that explains a lot of these things as well. So Shashank, I would give you the exact same advice that I gave the last portfolio. Do a full male character and a full female character. Again, we're gonna link the newest course, the Demon Character Creation course, because there's a lot of anatomy information in that one. I've always wanted to do an anatomy course, but I don't do it because it just doesn't sell. People don't like learning about anatomy for some reason. But I always try to like teach anatomy when I'm doing characters. So in this one, since he has a lot of like exposed muscles, you can learn a lot of that thing there as well. So if you haven't seen it, make sure to check it out. By the way, guys, should we tell them about the giveaway, Sarn?
Should we spoil them a little bit about what we're gonna do next week? I feel like it's a good time to let them know. Yeah, let's go. So, for those of you guys that don't know, my birthday is next week on Wednesday. August 30th is my birthday, and we're gonna have a giveaway. We're still working on the specifics, but if you want to stay tuned, or if you want to be like informed as soon as we have it there, make sure to join the Discord and be on all of our socials so that you can get it. We're going to be giving away some of the classes that we've released, and if you already have the classes, I'm going to be giving away a 1 hour session with me so that we can talk and cover whatever topic you want me to cover. So we're going to be giving three of this like prizes away next week on Wednesday on the 30th. It's going to be on a live stream, so we're going to be live streaming early that day, pretty much like at the same time right here. There you go. Welcome, Sanimation. Nah, you were watching, but you were not following. There you go. So now you're following. We're very close to our goal today. Just 4 more followers. So if you're watching, if you're not following, help us get there. And yeah, we're going to have, that's going to be our first giveaway for my birthday this and next week. So yeah, stay tuned because you can win some very cool prizes here. Some of our premium courses from Udemy or a 1 hour session, 1 hour art session with myself. There we go. So yeah, that's it, Shashank. Let's go to the next one. Mohamed Sass says, I'm currently preparing my portfolio for a game asset modeling and texturing position. This is my portfolio. Please guide me on what I should think or I'm doing wrong. Okay, let's take a look. Cool. This is really good. I think I've seen yours before because I do remember some of the characters that I'm seeing here or some of the assets. I think this is a really nice portfolio. But I'm going to be perfectly honest with you, Mohamed. This one right here, it's a little bit far from the mark, right? So again, it's a work in progress. I know you can still keep pushing it, but I honestly feel like there's a lot of like anatomy things that we still need to fix and finish. So I would probably take this one out because you have some very, very cool assets like this sword right here. This is really, 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 really nice. The only thing I would change about this sword is the same thing I've been mentioning about, which is the the metal edgeware being everywhere. Like, you don't want to have metal edgeware everywhere. And be careful with some design elements. I'm not sure if you were copying this from a concept. It kind of looks like you were. But having, like, the spikes here on the handle, that looks really, really, like, painful for the for the weapon itself. So I would probably remove that as well. This is a good topology. It's a little bit high for this sort of like low poly weapons. We're almost at 6k triangles. You could simplify this a little bit more, especially on this area. You could collapse some of the edges. So instead of having like a 12-sided cylinder going around, it could go down to like an 8-sided cylinder or like a 10-sided cylinder. That's gonna save you some polygons. But like this one right here, I really like the glow that you were able to create with the shader. That looks very, very clean, very nice. A lot cleaner. So my advice for your portfolio, Mohammed, would be to get rid of Thyros. You don't need him right now. I don't think it's gonna help you. And just keep everything else, because everything else looks really nice. This one looks really cool as well. I like this like chunky feel that you have to your to the weapons. Could be polished a little bit more. But as one of your first weapons 2 months ago, that's not bad. This character, I love this character. I've seen this concept before. I'm not sure where I saw it, but I've seen this concept before, I think. And this one's, it looks cool. I think you managed to capture the character quite nicely. So yeah, this looks good. This one looks really good. But I think this one's from a tutorial, right? I'm not sure if this is from a tutorial. Careful with the super sharp edges. Again, I will probably bevel them a little bit more. But that's a nice prop right there. Cool. Yeah, so again, my advice for you, Mohammed, just take out Thyros. You don't need him right now. Keep everything else. This renders right here, I'm not sure if I would include them because they do have a little bit of contrast. Someone asked this earlier today, is like, should I keep like two different like things like what you have right here, 3D game assets. I'll probably do it, to be honest, but here in the 3D game assets, you're missing some of them. So make sure you add all of the ones that are you're missing here on the 3D game assets. So we see that you're missing the new sword and you're missing this guy, I think. Yeah, the radar. So make sure to add those to your portfolio. Let's go with Max. Says, hello, Abraham. I'm Rakesh Kumar. I want to master 3D art. Can you please provide a guideline? Also, I have some question. Okay, let's open your portfolio first, and then I'll read your question. He says, rendering environments takes a lot of time. Are there any tips to reduce the render time? How long does an artist take to complete the model? For the Chesterfield chair, this one right here. For the Chesterfield chair, it takes me 8 hours. For the Wacom case, it takes me 12 hours. It looks easy, but it takes some time to figure out the shape. And am I taking a lot of time? In the weapon case, I can see some stretching in the bevel areas after smoothing or subdivision mode. Are there any ways to fix this? Or do I need to redo my texture after the smoothing? Thank you. Okay, so let's answer the first question. Rendering environments. Can we do something to render environments faster, like this one right here? If the environment is a closed environment like this one, then usually it's not as simple because you do need to have everything active so that the light bounces around nicely. But when you're doing this sort of like outdoor scenes where you have like a foreground, a middle ground, and a background, one thing that you can do is you can separate them into render layers and then composite them that back at the end. I don't like this piece. I'm gonna be honest here, Rakesh. I don't like this piece, and the reason why I don't think this is a good piece is because you're doing very, very splotchy work on the textures of the things, right? So if you're gonna be doing this scene right here, like this coffee shop in the like a trolley cabin, just focus on this. Like, just focus on this shot. Don't waste time doing everything else. Just focus on this shot and spend more time on it. I can see that this texture is like a 2K texture for the whole trolley. That's not how you do a big asset like this one. You probably want to use UDIMS or procedural texturing with masks and things like that, because as you can see, you get a lot of stretching. And I can see the cuts right here, right here, right here. It just looks very, very, very like weird in general. So you want to be careful in how you present this sort of stuff. And I don't think this is a great piece, to be honest, especially because of the texture quality. Now, you mentioned that you did this this weapon case. The render is not bad. The texture looks okay. Again, you went a little bit crazy here on the metal edgeware. I will need to see your topology. I understand what you're mentioning here with the stretching of the texture. Usually by adding some support edges, you can hide that and make sure that the stretching is not as bad. But it can be a little bit tricky, especially if the topology is not flowing properly. So you gotta be very, very careful there. Because otherwise, yeah, this errors are very, what's the word? Are very, I wouldn't say very common, but relatively common. Spending 12 hours to model this one, to model the case. What do you guys think? I want to hear you guys. What do you guys think? Should this model take 12 hours to model? How long would it take you guys, roughly? Because this is a question that I get asked quite a bit. Like, how long should it take to model something? Backbook says 4 to 5 hours. Sarn says, that's a good question, right? Just for the model, 3-4 hours, maybe. Yeah, if I was asking one of my artists to do this asset, I would probably expect him to take like a full day. So 8 hours of work. And given that you usually don't work like 8 hours at your full potential every day, it's probably going to be like a 2-day project, right? It's like, okay, the first day you're going to model maybe some UVs and basic textures, and then the second day you're going to do the rest of the elements. So I would say that, yeah, something like this, especially if you want like clean topology here flowing, making sure that everything opens and animates and things like that, probably like 2 days of work is relatively expected. Same for this chair right here, especially because of the cloth. It depends on how like crazy or not you want to go for the cloth, if you want to model it or if you want to just texture it, but it would be expected to spend a little bit more time on this one. Careful with the UVs, man. I feel like you're suffering quite a bit from the UVs. Like this bar right here, all along this border, that's a perfect place to place a UV seam line to help keep everything else a little bit more uniform. Because right now, I mean, again, from afar it doesn't look bad, but when you get a little bit closer, you can start seeing some of the issues. I'm not sure about this, like, little tiny wheels. I will need to see the original concept to see if that's how it works, because it looks very weird. But yeah, it's not a bad model. Let's take a look at this. Yeah, the render here is killing you, man. Like, totally killing you. I'm not sure what you're using to render, but it's just
it's just so flat. There's also a lot of noise. Careful with those camera movements. Those are very, very rushed camera movements. I think we're gonna have a little bit of time. I think we're gonna have a little bit of time today, and I'm gonna show you how to do those like softer camera movements, because this is, it's a little bit too harsh. Like, if this is what you meant by things taking too long to render, I understand. But before worrying about the render time, you should be worrying about the render quality. So you need to make sure that the render looks as nice as it can with like good light. And this right now is not giving you the best light possible. Yeah, same for this bee. Like, if we look for a close-up of a bee. Close-up bee. There we go. I understand what you were going for, because bees do look very hairy, like this one right here. But you can see that the hair has color to it, right? Like, it's not like all brown. It has like colors depending on what part of the bee, like the hair is at. You can also see that the hair is not perfectly uniform. There's a little bit of like noise and things like that. And right now this just looks like, look at that. Look at that perfect cut right there on the hair. Again, it's not ideal of what we want. So if you're using Action, I can guess that you're using Action. You need to use a couple of like modifiers to make that action look a little bit better. Should we do an action tutorial, guys, for YouTube? Like a basic action overview? What do you think? Yes, please, says Backboy immediately. Yeah, let's do one. Next week, I'll record one action tutorial then. Just to show you the basics of how to do it. And because this sort of stuff is very common, right? Like doing just like a very basic furry, like little creature like this one. It's relatively common, and it's not difficult to get this sort of result. But again, one of the things that you guys are, or in this case, one of the things that that Rakesh is missing is the light. Like, this is so... It's such a simple light that's not really allowing you to generate some nice like effects on the hair. Okay, so we gotta work on the light, and then this camera right here. Rakesh, I honestly would recommend, again, if you wanna check our Discord, the weapon, the AAA weapon creation. It's for Blender, but you can still use all of the information for Maya. That will teach you like the proper way to do a workflow. And not only that, I spend like anytime I record a course, I like to spend at least one chapter on rendering, because again, rendering is so important. So I think you can benefit quite a bit from that one. Let's now jump with Nikita. Says, hi Abraham, my name's Nikita. I'm a self-taught 3D artist with just about a year of experience behind me. I want to get a job as a junior artist, but to wonder what I'm still missing to be more competitive. Let's take a look. Nice. Looks good. Okay, so let's take a look. This is a nice model. It's a good practice for modeling. Wireframe. For this one, Nikita, we need a wireframe. We need a wireframe to see how you managed to solve all of these issues. But I like the fact that you were able to capture like all of the shapes of the element. This like definitely looks like a can opener. It might seem like a simple prop, but again, if you can show your process, this can definitely be a valuable portfolio piece. We got a samurai helmet, a little like shrine or environment. Here is where, again, the depth of field could really benefit you, because we would like blur out the background a little bit so that's not as prominent. I'm not sure the amount of light that we have on the HDRI matches with the amount of light that we're seeing here on the inside. So here's where I would probably add like a fake light just hitting the side of the helmet so that we got a little bit more light, because one of the, this shot, oh, this shot is really good. I don't know what it is, but this shot is really clean. It looks really, really nice. Some of the materials do look a little bit CG, but this shot looks way, way nicer. I think it's because of the contrast between warm and cool. But yeah, you can see it right here. Love the contrast of the cold core and the warm light coming from the doorway. Yeah, this is a really, really nice photograph. And you could trick a lot of people into thinking that this is like real. If we added a little bit more detail, you know, like a little bit of dust, maybe like a like something like a paper, I don't know, like something on this scene, that one looks really good. But here I'm still like a little bit curious because we don't see the sword, we don't see the helmet, like it's not really showing. And that's very hurtful because it's supposed to be the main thing of the scene and we're not able to appreciate it. So changing the light on this one a little bit might be the best option for that particular piece. Because you did a really good job on this one. This looks really, really nice. I love this one. Really nice work here on the fibers, on the knots. That one looks really cool as well. Yeah, this is a good one. It's a good piece right there. That one I would definitely keep. The helmet, I don't love. You did a good job here with the action. That's a lot better. Because you can see a little bit of variation on the mustache shape. But a lot of the things look very like wonky, very soft, very smooth. They don't look as sharp. So I will probably... Same for this one. I've never done a samurai helmet, to be honest. But I think I remembered like all of these little things are like individual plates. And that's the way you want to do them. You want to do like each individual plate as a single element. So that it really shows the whole like complexity of the element. This shot right here is really cool. It's a simple shot, but it works. I would probably use displacement for the ground here. Again, it's a nice plate, but the sand looks a little bit like this. Ooh, this shot looks really nice. Really nice contrast here on this tablet. I would probably use this one both of us a thumbnail are good. Now here, what you could do is expand this, maybe do like a ruined floor, like an obelisk or something like that. To get a like slightly more complex scene going, right? And again, don't forget to try to use some displacement on the ground, because right now it looks very flat. It doesn't look like it's really like grains of sand. There was this Pixar Piper, I think it was called. Yeah. So this one, I don't remember which movie they showed this short before the movie, but I was reading or doing some research about the making of, and what they did is they actually like every single grain of sand, it's an actual geometry. So it's an instance geometry. It's crazy. This is not displacement. Like they actually render every single grain of sand. Of course they don't render underneath them. It's just like a thin plane of sand, but that's why sand looks so good on this one, because it's like a geometry. It's like actual geometry. Now, of course I understand that we don't have this amount of computing power usually in our houses. They use like render farms and things like that. But you can see how much it helps to have like individual grains of sand on the character right here. It really makes it look like it's a ground, like a ground plane. So that was Nikita right there. And now we go to Phantom. Phantom, are you on the chat, my friend? It's your turn now. Yeah, we're gonna buy a whole like render farm just to render sand. Is Phantom on the chat? Phantom has been working on a very cool project. He's been showing it on the Discord. Let's take a look. So it says, I'm Rishav Jain. I'm a self-taught 3D artist working in the gaming industry for a few months as a 3D artist. I once specialized in creating characters and creatures. Would appreciate if you could give feedback and the current portfolio and guide me in picking the next project. Cheers. Let's go. So... nice! This guy right here. This one was the first tutorial I did. Ooh, what was it? Like 4 or 5 years ago? It was with a different company called Victory 3D. And they hired me to do this tutorial. That's cool. That's a cool character. Like this plant guy. I love this one. I think this one, my friend, it's a great, great result. The presentation looks good. The cloth looks good. This is like a Sith character, right? From Star Wars. Oh, look at that. You took the plant guy and then you made it a Jedi character. Welcome, Ali Hartist, to the stream. Welcome. This is very clever. Very, very clever. And this is something that I've suggested before. You don't have to do everything from scratch every single time. So here, what Rishav did is he took his old work, this one right here,
and he gave it a new, like, literal coat of paint and presented it in a way better light, and look at how much nicer this looks. It still has some issues, some things that I would change anatomy-wise, like the connections of some of the muscles here are not looking super, super clean. But you kind of like hide that, or you forget about that by looking at some like other parts of the character. So I think here, my friend, one of the things that I would suggest is remove a couple of your works. Like this girl right here, I don't love it. It looks very weird. It looks very scary. Proportions are not great. So I'll probably take this one out and probably this dragon as well. Because this looks like just polypaint, I think. No, it does have UVs. Yeah, so I'll probably take these two guys out, the dragon and the girl, because Illidan, this guy right here, the eye, the jacket, and this guy, they do look like some nice pieces for your portfolio. And of course, we can see the grow. This is very important. This is another question that I get every now and then, where people ask me, should I take or hide my old works now that I'm getting better and better? And the answer is usually no, because a good recruiter will understand that you grow as an artist, and seeing that growth is also important to understand that you can be pushed even further, right? So what recruiters want, especially when you're trying to break into the industry, what a recruiter is looking for is they want an artist that can do the job that they're, or the work that they're looking for, but also that can grow and bring something to the table, right? So if they see your growth as an artist, that also gives them like more security that you're a good bet and that you will be a good member of the team. So that's what I'm seeing right here. Like we see this guy right here, this like plant guy that looked okay for the first like a project that you did back in last year. And then we see this guy right here, and the shot, like just this shot alone, looks really, really nice. Looks way better. Again, still a couple of things that I would fix, but the presentation, everything looks really nice. And this one was done 4 months ago. So that tells me that in the span of like about 8 months, you went from this thing to this thing. That's really good. That shows a lot of potential. And again, it can help a recruiter find you more appealing as a candidate. This Illidan is really good as well. I really like what you did with the action and everything. I'll probably add a little bit of noise to this part right here. It looks very uniform. And one of the things that we definitely need to fix here, Phantom, is the light. The light of the character, or the light of the first renders, is very, very, very simple, very flat. And you did an amazing job on the other character, on the red character, that I would like to see replicated on this one right here. So I would definitely like to see this sort of like dramatic cinematic light on this character being projected onto this one right here. Cool, so that was a Phantom, a good member of our Discord. If you are not on the Discord and you want to hear about the giveaway that we're going to have next week and about all of the tutorials and informations that we're uploading, make sure to subscribe. We're going to share the link in just a second. This was my first time using Unreal Engine, wasn't happy with it in the end. Again, the models and the textures are really good. It's just the light, and the light in Unreal is definitely a little bit tricky, but it should be like I'm sure your next projects are gonna be really good, man. So just keep pushing. Let's see how many we have missing. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Oh, we still got 6, 7. Oh my god, 8, 9. Oh my god, 9 more. Okay, so I'm gonna speed up a little bit because we have about 30 minutes left. Let's see. Hello, Abraham. Glad to have found your new channel. You might recognize some of my pieces from previous contests. Every step of Fitch Design is 100% created by me. And this is Lance Weff. There we go. Yeah, Lance was is a very good student of ours. He did this concept piece, this popcorn cannon. Very, very cool weapon. And this like shark, like zombie shark creature. Very, very cool as well. So Lance, those two pieces are really good. I still feel like some of the... Oh, this was for the Endless Engine Challenge. Nice, nice. Yeah, I still feel like we need to find, and I think I've mentioned this before, we need to find one piece, one concept piece
and try to follow and do it, because right now I think you have a really creative like mind, which is really, really good. But we also need to show, especially if you want to, I'm not sure if you're already in the industry or not, I think you're not just yet because you're seeking for a 3D artist role. So you need to show people, you need to show recruiters that you can grab a concept, or you can be handed a concept, and you can copy or follow that concept as nicely and as close as possible. So, oh, that's a very nice fuzzy ball right there. That's really cool. Yeah, it's a, like, I can see that you know the process. Now you just need to show that you know how to apply this process to a concept. My best advice is, if you want to do characters or creatures, to grab one like a cool creature concept. For instance, cool creature concept. Or like the dryad I showed you before with those big arms. That sort of stuff, it's really cool. But there are a lot of concepts out there that you can use. You can go really like creepy and realistic, or you can go like whimsical and funny. But yeah, there's a lot of things that you can grab from the artists. Like, I don't know if that's like a great one, but I'm clicking on that one to see if we get some more variations. Like this guy right here. Like, this is a funny guy. It's a fun, cool, like, lizard, and you can learn a lot from doing a project like this. And it has, like, a lot of, like, charisma on the face and stuff. So my advice for you, Lance, is try to grab a concept. Like, you need to have a little bit more things here in your portfolio, because four pieces, especially if you're already looking for a job, four pieces, it's on the low side of things. I will always recommend, like, 7 to 10 pieces, and they need to be 7 to 10 really good pieces. So your next three pieces should be trying to follow a concept. Try not to do all original work, always. Galar says, hello, I would love to get feedback from you on my portfolio, but I'm not fluent in English. Would you have a way to put the important points in writing so I can translate it? Yes, Galar, of course. However, I'm not sure if you submitted before the close-up to today. But if you submit for September's portfolio review, I can write them down for you so that you can find it easier. So yes, I can do that. Cool, so that was Lance. Let's close this. Let's go with Limitless. Says, hello, Abraham. I'm a university student. I'm in my senior year, and I'm trying to figure out which pieces are my strongest and anything I could do to present my work better for recruiters. Joseph Medina from Orlando. Okay, cool. Nice. So if you ask me which of these pieces are the best, I would say the Nintendo is really good. The Master Sword is really good. This Glock is good. This chair is really nice, and maybe the rifle. This one I don't love, and the reason I don't like this one is the textures. I feel like the textures are very plasticky. They don't look as nice. However, you could you could improve these textures in a similar way to what you did with the chair. Let's go over here with the chair, because this chair looks way, way better. It doesn't look as glossy. So if you can match the textures on that guy to the same like sort of like chair effect that you have right here, that could be a little bit better. This already gives me a couple of issues. So all of these little triangles that you see here, this very like thin border that you see here, this kind of tells me that you probably did an automatic mapping for this thing. Automatic mappings are not bad, but they're not great either, because especially from a game perspective, every UB cut that you have, it's extra performance. It's like a little performance hit. So it's not the same thing to have an object with like 10 UB cuts than to have an object with like 100 UB cuts. It might not look different from a texturing perspective, but from again, from a performance perspective in the engine, it can be a little bit different. So you wanna do proper UVs. We have a video about that on the channel. Now, one of the things that I'm seeing here is that you're doing a lot of fan art. Fan art is fine. We've talked about this before. Fan art is perfectly fine. However, you also need to do original work, and you also need to follow concepts. This Pokeball, it's not a difficult concept. Again, it's something that you can do relatively quickly. So it's going to get you views, it's going to get you likes, but it's not going to get you a job, or a recruiter is not going to be like impressed by that. The Master Sword, on the other hand, since it's a more complete prop, it's a weapon, and you did a good job on the textures and on the model, That's why I wouldn't advise of, like, taking this one out. But probably the Pokeball, this rifle right here, this one, like, I'll probably take them out. And again, just look for cool concepts online that you can use. I can definitely see that you want to do video games, which is great. I can see that you want to do hard surface. Well, do a complex hard surface object. That will be one of the things. Remember that hard surface artists, and this is for everyone, by the way, guys. Remember, guys, that I put the music back on. If you want to be a prop artist doesn't mean only like weapons and armor. It means weapon, armor, household items, environment things such as mailboxes. Welcome, Galar. Oh, now you're following. You were not following, but you're not following. Thank you, my friend. Oh, just 2 followers away from our goal today. Let's see if we get there. So keep in mind that you will need to do a lot of different things. And some things might not be as glamorous of other things, but if you can show that you can do like a wide range of elements, that's going to give you, again, more points as an artist. I would also recommend upping up the complexity of your objects. So the Blender course that I have, the Weapon Blender course, might be a good idea. Even if you're a Maya user, again, you can use the same concepts and just do it in Maya and ZBrush. And the point is to do a more complex things, because pretty much the level of complexity of the Master Sword is not the same thing as the level of complexity of Frostmourne, right, from World of Warcraft. So you want to show that you can do complex things as well. So that was Joseph Medina. Let's now go with Sanjay Danda. He says, "Hey Abraham, here's my current portfolio. I studied at Vertex School to be a character artist, but I also love props. Still working towards applying for roles in the industry. I'm working on a few projects to update it soon. I mainly post whips on my Instagram too." Great. Let's take a look. Hello, Sanimation. Okay, so Sanjay has a couple of assets here. This is really cool. This one looks really nice. Really nice, but it's a simple prop. That would be my main. Oh, I like this, like broken effect. The main thing that I would say is just a simple prop. So if you're gonna be doing a window, try doing a window, a door, a small window, a big door, like multiple elements, so that you can show that you have like range, right? Because just a simple window, and we can probably see this here on the views and on the likes, it's just 7 and 255. So if we compare that to, let's say, the house, it's a more complete element. There you go, 31, and you can see that you have way more likes, maybe not as many views, but way more likes because it's a more complex object. And I can see that you're probably reusing the same thing, which is great. It's a part of the house. Okay, that's great. Yeah, that's great, Sanjay. So yeah, my advice would be then, I mean, you don't need the window by itself. If you're going to be showing the house, you can show the window probably on this project as well. It's a nice low poly house. This one I really like. Vertex School is, I don't know where the Vertex School is. Is that the one from, I always forget his name. Ryan Kingsley? I think it is, right? That's the school from Ryan Kingsley? I'm not sure. So yeah, this is a good prop. Yeah, there you go, Ryan Kingsley. Yeah, I'm a huge fan of him. By the way, he was one of my first, or I learned a lot from him when I was just starting 10 years ago. Really good guy, really cool guy. So yeah, this is a really good prop. I like the textures. I think the bump is a little bit too intense on this side right here. Are you using 2K or 4K maps on this one? Because I feel, yeah, see, this was my suspicion. I'm not sure. I will need to see how you unfolded this. Because 2K, yeah, I'm not sure how you unfolded this, because there's a big issue right here. Look at the surface area that the main, like, this bronze or like element occupies, and then look at the surface area that all of the other elements occupy. And then if you compare it to the map, look at how small this is. Super, super small. So you have a very, very, like, low resolution for a very, very big part. This island right here should be way, 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 way bigger. And that's mainly an unfold issue on the elements, not really a modeling issue, because the modeling is fine. So it's the unfold. Something happened on the unfold that you did not get a uniform distribution of all of the elements. And of course, if we don't have a uniform distribution, we're not going to get good resolution on all of the elements. My advice would be to redo the textures for this one. I know it can be a little bit like, what's the word? Time consuming to just redo everything, but it's such a good model that I think it deserves it. I think it deserves for you to give it another pass. This is a cool character, but it's a little bit simple on the forms themselves. It looks like just like very soft plates all over the character, and I would like to see a little bit more complexity. It's not a bad piece for the portfolio because there's a lot of like detail on the armors and the like belts and things like that. So I would not take it out. But if you want to be a character artist, I would do another character with a little bit more complexity. Let me show you. Paladin character concept. So if you want to do a warrior, here's a very, very common like archetype that people do when like picking characters. They'll tell me, hey, I want to do a paladin, I want to do a warrior, and I use this exercise quite a bit. This is what my teachers did with me when I was at Noman. They would tell you, get 10 concepts, like go online and look for 10 concepts of paladins that you like. And once you have 10 concepts, you're gonna like narrow those 10 concepts to only 3 concepts. And once you have those 3 concepts, the teacher is gonna pick the concept for you. Because if you pick the concept, you tend to be a little bit more lenient with yourself. You give yourself more permissions to break things. And when someone else picks the concept for you, which is what's gonna happen in the studio, you need to follow the instructions. So if you show me a concept like this, I will be like, no, it's a very cool concept. It's a very cool character, super tanky, super like epic, right? But this is not something that you're going to be able to, like probably at this level that you're in right now, it's not something that you're going to be able to like complete with the level of quality that we're expecting. However, something like this might be a little bit more like achievable, right? So we always need to again to be very mindful of where our current level as an artist is, and always shoot a little bit like further out, but not so like high that you don't manage to finish it or complete it. So it's a little bit difficult to do at first, but it's about like knowing your skills as an artist and understanding like, okay, for instance, do I want to do this? Yes, okay, cool. Do I know how to do hair? Do I know how to do cloth? Do I know how to do chainmail? Because if I don't know how to do all of those things, those are things I'm going to have to learn. If you don't have the time to learn those things, then the best idea would probably be to look for another type of concept so that it's not as complicated as what you have on the first like try. For instance, something like this is like, okay, in this one, the only maybe new thing I'm gonna have to learn is cloth. I'm gonna have to learn how to do cloth because everything else is relatively easy to follow or to complete. So that would be my advice, man. You have really good level, technical level. Like I can see that you understand the tools and the process nicely, but you need to have more pieces and you need to showcase that level of precision in the new pieces. Okay? Yeah, you're welcome. Backboy says, true, something that's happening with me serious course is that I work better when someone tells me what to do rather than letting me imagine things and recreate. And that's fine. I was mentioning this on the last video, like doing and following tutorials, it's great. That's the first step in learning anything, right? Like it's very difficult to just open the software and expect you to know everything. You need someone to tell you how to do it. I had people in my life. I still like follow people that teach me things about Blender and Substance and things like that. You always are learning. That's why we have the our logo, right? Like always learning, always improving, but you need to try to learn that information and then see how you can transfer the information into something new and something original. So it's fine to follow the tutorial at first, but for instance, in your case, Backboy, as soon as you finish the ZBrush course, try to see how could you implement that into something like different. Like if you're doing the Oni course, if I look for Oni concept art, you're gonna find something that's very similar. You're gonna be like, hey, you know what? Like, I don't know, like this guy right here. Like, it's a little bit complex. There's a lot of like armor and pieces and things like that. But you could apply all of the things that you're learning on that course, and you should be able to do all of this character that you're seeing right here. And then after that, after you do like a different concept, like the next stage would be, okay, now I'm gonna do my own concept. Now that I followed the tutorial, now that I've used the tutorial tools to do another piece, now I can use all of those like two experiences to do my own piece. And that's when you start developing your own sort of like sense of design and artistic voice,
which definitely takes a little bit of time to get there, but that's the general process. Okay, let's go with Nortox. Nortox says he has a year of modeling. Cool. So for you, Dennis, from Ukraine, I think, and sorry if I'm being a little bit harsh, I think we're not ready to have these things on the portfolio. This one is really good. I think this one's probably your best piece, this goblin sculpt. But if you want to have a valuable piece here in your portfolio, you need to go through the whole process. So you need to have your goblin piece, do the retopology, do proper textures, skins, and renders to showcase, again, the best possible result. This dwarf right here, some anatomy things that still need to be figured out. This one's not bad. I think the light is what's hurting you right now. I can see that you're doing the render in Marmoset. Remember, guys, that Marmoset nowadays in the newest version, it has a ray tracing thing that you can turn on. Make sure to turn on the ray tracing because it's very, very important to get a nice result on your renders. Same thing for this house. Like, it's very low poly. Like, nowadays, we're not doing this anymore on environment pieces. This is very, very simplistic, and we can, like, yeah, this trim sheet is fine, but if you're gonna be doing trim sheets, there's better ways to show how to do trim sheets than this one right here. And this dragon right here, eyes column, again, it looks a little bit simple. So my advice is, we gotta keep learning. I'm not sure if what softwares you're using. It seems like for modeling, it seems like Maya. So again, the weapon course might be a good idea for this one, for you, Dennis, to improve a little bit on your skills. I can see that you're still a student, which is fine. Like, this was done 8 months ago, so you're in your first year of learning 3D. That's great. It usually takes about 2 years to start getting to like this, like a junior level. So you're in a good position, but we need to polish those skills. Let's go with the next one. It says, hello everyone, this is my portfolio. I want to work in films as a visualizer or make cinematics. So I try to keep on making some previous shots and all, but don't know how to go to film line through 3D. Currently, I'm planning to do 3D modeling, and from that route, I want to work in films and VFX. Let's see. This is Kushagra Chaturvedi. Okay. Okay, I see a little bit of everything, which is interesting. It's a little bit all over the place. So this is interesting. I like the contrast on the colors. However, the way that the images are being kind of like merged together, they don't flow as nicely on this particular piece. That was 10 months ago. Let's go for the Gundams. These Gundams are interesting. Completely model texture lining, everything done by me. Okay. Yeah, you're going for this anime-ish style, which is fine. It's too noisy. I think this shot right here, it's a little bit too noisy. And one thing that I can notice is that the Gundams are in this like T poses. Like, this guy's not even looking at this other guy. He seems to be in this T pose. So if you're modeling everything, one of the very important things that you need to do is you need to show the wireframes. We want to see the wireframes because this does look good. Like, I could definitely see this on like an anime show. But if we don't see the wireframes, it's going to be very difficult to... There we go. It's going to be very difficult to evaluate how they would perform on an element. I can see that you can immediately see that the head has a lot of topology. So I would like to see a close-up shot of why that is. I really like the shader, though. You did a great job with this, like, anime shader. This is one of the things that I want to learn how to do, because I haven't done a lot of this. So the model is good. You definitely, if you want to do like previs and things like that, one of the things that I would suggest is trying to incorporate this into other shots. Yeah, this is a really complex modeling. This is good. Blender, that's great. But I think it's complicated for your portfolio, Kushagra, because it's a little bit all over the place. So I'm not sure what is it you want to do. I understand on the message that you were mentioning that you wanted to do, it says right here, you want to do cinematics. But if you want to do anime cinematics,
that's another thing that just doing like traditional cinematics, right? Yeah, because you're modeling at some point. Like this is great. This works. I guess my advice for you, my friends, would be to try to nail down exactly what is it that you want to do, because I see more like anime modeling and shading things right here than previous things. I can see some shots here on the cars and things like that for previous, but previous is not only cars. There's a lot of things for previous that you could also like learn about, and we need to work on this. If you're doing this for like matte paintings, we need to work a lot more on the depth and things like that. So for you, I think I would definitely like do or keep it like this, because if we see this as a 3D modeling, this looks a little bit more consistent. And maybe if you really don't want to do concept art, don't do concept art. Like, don't include this in your portfolio, because it can be confusing for a recruiter, because you don't really know what it is that you want to do. Okay. So let's go. That was Kushagra. Let's now go with Jordan. Says, hi Abraham, I've recently just graduated from my university studying animation and visual effects. Throughout the course, I grew a love for character and creature design and want to keep on improving my skills in that field. Everything I've learned in ZBrush is all thanks to you, so I will be incredibly grateful if on your feedback. Okay, let's go. So, cool. First things that I see is that we have some really clean renders and some other renders that are not great. So, for instance, this monster spawn right here, not great. It's just a very simple sphere with just, like, teeth and things. So, probably take that one out. I really like this, like, king thing. I would suggest if you're not watching the ZBrush course right now to maybe take a look at it or join Art of Our Social so that you can maybe win it on the giveaway, because there's some anatomy issues on this one that we need to fix to make these muscles a lot more defined and more just to make them flow a little bit better. But I like that one. This one is really good. I really like the composition of this one. Nice light, nice touch right here. This one, yeah, this is some very nice graphic language for this character. So that's really, really good stuff right there. Very creepy. You're going for this very creepy vibe. And I love this one. This, like, super clean Pokemons are very cool. So this Quagmire. What will be missing from this ones are some wireframes to make sure that they can, like, properly... They can be rigged properly and we could, like, eventually use them in the games. Yeah, this one's very cool as well. Yeah, fan arts. I've mentioned this before, guys. Fan arts are great. They give you a lot of points, a lot of like visualizations. Careful with the renders. I know you can do good renders. I would recommend you do another render for that one, so it's a little bit more in line with this guy's, like, just clean, like, happy renders. This one's fun as well. Porygon. Tangela. Yeah, here I would probably get rid of the environment and just keep the Pokemons, because I feel like the environment's hurting you a little bit on the render side of things. Spooky. Interesting. I'm not sure. The clouds are added post, right? In post-production, I think. So yeah, maybe without the clouds, this would might look a little bit cleaner. So I think you have a good spot. My advice, if you want to do characters and creatures, you need to do a typical, again, human male character, human female character, a typical monster like a dragon, like a troll, like a goblin, like a giant, something like that, so that you can show the process. And it's very important that you show the whole process. Character artists need to know the whole process. They need to do modeling, sculpting, retopology, texturing, rendering, everything. Very, very important. Let's go with Ali. Hi, I'm Ali. I want to be a character artist, especially for facial modeling. This is my art station. I hope Abe review it. Many thanks. There you go, man. This is looking good. I can definitely see the likenesses of the characters. We can still like improve them a little bit more. Good job on the action. I'm guessing that's action there for the character. So I can definitely see this is good. You're in a good position. But we need to improve the specific points. Do not share works in progress. So here you have a couple of like this one. Don't have this one, the sugar one. Same for this one. Just finish works. Finish works. This one's a little bit better. I don't love the fiber mesh. I'm not sure if you're planning on finishing this. I would still consider this to be a work in progress. You are getting close on the likeness, and I like the poly paint, but you need to retopologize and bring this into Maya to do some proper renders. This one does look like a proper render. I don't see the Brad Pitt likeness, to be honest. So we definitely need to work a little bit more on that. But I can see where we're going. Now, I know that you're mentioning that you only want to do faces. And the faces are very important. But you also need to do everything else. Because if you don't do everything else, then it's very difficult to get a job just as like as a face artist. So we need to improve things. We need to be a little bit more specific on the details. This is not like I don't see the likeness on Walter White on this one, to be honest. So I think from likenesses, Chigurh and Ryan Gosling are probably the ones that you got the closest to. I don't really see Brad Pitt on this one, and I don't really see Walter White on this one. So be very careful on there. Look for Hossein Diva. I think that's his name. He's a really, really, really cool character artist, and he does a lot of likenesses. So he's a great point of inspiration. Let's now go with Egg. Says, oh, I'm not too late either. I'm Jesse, and I recently started studying digital film design. I'm in the second semester right now. I'm doing my first 3D short film at the moment. It's nearly done. I've been dabbling in 3D for maybe a year now. Did a lot of digital painting before with minimal 3D sometimes. Let's take a look. The Collector. Nice. Ooh, this one's... Okay, so here's the thing. I can definitely see, Jesse, your film, what's the word? Inspiration or not inspiration? Influence. Because people who study film, who study cinematography, because I can definitely see some like 3D things, like issues on form and anatomy and things like that. But even with those like issues, let's say quote unquote issues, the way you're presenting this is really good, and that has to do with composition, filmography or cinematography. So all of the shots are really good. Again, even if the 3D is not like the best, the way you're like conveying this information is really, really, really good. This kind of shots is very important. And the reason why it's also very important, guys, Jesse here, it's a great example of that, is we always need to think of the final product, right? So we need to understand that our stuff, our like work, our... what's the word? Our renders, everything, they're going to be used somewhere. It could be a cinematic, it could be a game, it could be a film. So we need to think of them as how they're going to be seen on the final like shots, right? Let's take a look at this one, for instance. I'm going to fast forward because we're running a little bit out of time. But yeah, look at this. Like, from a technical perspective, 3D-wise, it might not be the best 3D. But from a film perspective, from a conceptual perspective, this works. Because it's telling a story. Okay? We gotta be careful with those animations. Always try to soft them and smooth them out here and there. But this is good. So you don't always need to have like the super best 3D as long as you can tell a story. We can see some breakdowns right here. I love this shot right here. I love the cover. Yeah, so all of these things that we're seeing here from Jesse, this is amazing. Because this is design, okay? So remember, there's like two main like things in the world, in the 3D world. There's the design part of things where you think about how things are gonna look. And then there's the technical execution part of things, like making sure that whatever you imagine, it's now like projected onto the screen, right? So as you can see, we got this like collector dude right here, who's amazing, looks very, very, very cool. We got the main character right here as well. And then we see the final result, the storyboard, everything. So yeah, if we take a look at this, and I'm completely critical about this, there's a lot of things 3D-wise that can be improved. UV mapping, there's some like shading here on the legs. Proportions are good. Same for the girl and stuff, but you can see the reconstruction that we're doing here, and for the type of style and the type of storytelling that we're going for, this, I would say, is a successful project. So, this is great, Jesse. You're a great concept artist and designer. This is amazing. I would love to do some of your pieces as a 3D piece. I love that guy. If you can do a concept art of that guy, I'll do a 3D any day. Like, that's a great one. This is really, really, really good. Really amazing. Yeah, congratulations, Jesse. This is really, really nice. Now, if you want to do more 3D, that's great. But to be honest, from what I've seen on this side from you, I think you have more potential as a cinematographer, like setting the tone and the design of things. because this is the kind of stuff that you don't see frequently. So I would push you to go towards that sort of stuff instead of 3D. I like keep doing 3D if you like doing 3D, but your artistic sensitivity on this sort of like compositions and things is really, really good. This is really good as well. I like it. Cool. Let's go now with Ajesh. Ajesh has a couple of elements right here. Okay, cool. I don't remember if I've seen this one before. I think so. So this guy, Nuka-Cola, this guy, and the guitar, good pieces. This two guys right here, I would probably take them out, my friend. And we need to work a little bit more on the renders. Like this one right here has rust everywhere. We gotta be careful where we add the rust and where we leave it clean. The optimization is fine. 11K triangle is great for an object like this. So maybe just like tone the intensity down a little bit more and add other types of stickers or things like that to this particular piece. The reason why I don't love the environments is because they are, again, very low poly, very simple. This is kind of like PlayStation 2, PlayStation 1 kind of quality. So nowadays, the environments that we see in games are way, way, way higher than this. It's very weird that they're going to ask you to do this sort of like level. Unless it's for like a mobile game or something, you're probably going to be working on something a little bit more advanced. And the guitar, that's the final point that I'm going to give you here, my friend. The guitar, I would recommend doing a different kind of render. It's not a bad model. Textures are not bad either, but the render is really, really, really hurting you. So we need to work on a simple 3-point light setup or something like that. It's probably going to be more than enough. Okay, cool. So that was it. However, Matthews, are you here in the chat? You just... Oh, you're Galar. Okay. So Matthews, I'm gonna give you, I'm gonna review your stuff before we finish. So Matthews, this is really good. Really good. Weapons. Yeah, this is really nice. Really clean. Wireframes. Okay. We need wireframes. So wireframes are the renders where we see the topology of your object, because I'm not sure, it says here it's game ready, but I don't see the poly count, I don't see the maps, and I don't see the wireframe, okay? So let me write, because you asked for it. So wireframes, map renders, and poly count. We need to see that on this one right here. Yeah, this ones are really clean. Yeah, like this. So try to add poly frames everywhere and poly count. I want to see, I can see it right here, 40k. Another thing that you need to try to do is try to do the same weapon at different LODs. These are called LODs. So LODs are the level of details. And if you can have this same weapon with half the triangles, that would be good as well, because not every game will allow you to have as many triangles as what you have right here. This one's really, really good, but not every game will have that amount of effect. I really like the bow right here. Now, the problem with weapons, Matthews, is that there is a lot of competition, right? A lot of people are doing weapons. Now, you do have a lot of talent. I can see that these are really clean and good weapons. However, if you want to play it safe, my advice is try to do something and the weapons, okay? So what other things could you do other than weapons? You could do vehicles. You could do like assets, like capsules or trucks or like the environment pieces. I always tell you guys like sci-fi props. Because you use the same information or you use the same processes for this kind of things, right? And it shows that you have range and that you're not only doing weapons. So my advice would be to also try to do this sort of things as well. I know they're not weapons, they're more like environment pieces, but that's like as an asset, as a 3D asset guy, this is a good way to learn and to do cool stuff. Okay? So we're just one follower away. Is someone viewing and not following? Do you guys want to be the 310 follower? If you do, we're gonna get to our goal today.
And then we're gonna get to our goal before finishing, because right now we're about to finish our stream and continue working on some very cool stuff that we're preparing for you guys. So before we finish, my friends, a couple of announcements. We are gonna have our giveaway next week. So if you want to get the chance to win one of our courses or a 1 hour private session with me to talk about your portfolio, 3D or anything that you want, please make sure to go into our Discord and join the Discord so that you can be part of this giveaway. And other than that, remember to subscribe to our YouTube channel where we're uploading shorts and videos very, very frequently so that you too can learn more about the 3D world. So that's it for this one, my friends. I think there's no more news. Stay tuned for more information and I'll see you back on the next one. Bye-bye.